Morning, students. Let's continue our chapter number one of part A, Human Geography, Nature and Scope. In the last lecture, we discussed about the geography. What is geography? Some definition, important definition of human geography, branches of geography, and the process, the changing process of human beings through naturalization of humans and humanization of nature, in which we discuss the first term, naturalization of humans, right? The second was possibilism. How the possibilism come? It comes through the technology. When human beings interact with their physical environment with the help of technology, like two elements were sitting on a hilltop and they were rubbing the stones. The sparking were come from the stones. From there, they came to know about the law of friction, right? So they these technology helps the human beings to interact with the environment and to improve their lives, their lifestyles. Is the reason we are facing the present time today. So it is not important what human beings produce and create, but it is extremely important with the help of what tools and techniques do they produce and create. Like in the ancient times or in the primitive times, some stone age was there. The tools were made up of stones. Then the iron age comes, wooden age comes. So according to the ages, our tools and techniques are also keep on changing, right? So technology, basically the technology indicates the level of culture or the cultural development of society. When the human beings were using the tools made by stone, that age is known as the stone age. After that, the iron age comes, copper age comes, right? So this process shows that the technology and the tools in this considered the ages or the cultural development of the society. It determines the technology and the tool determines the cultural development of the society. Human beings were able to develop technology, but they were able to develop the technology by understanding the natural laws. For example, the understanding of concepts of friction and heat helped us to discover the fire. As I told you the story of the two elements, they were rubbing the stones and whatever, and from there we came to know about the law of friction and heat, and we developed a lot of things with the help of this law, right? Second example is understanding of the secrets of DNA and genetics, which enable us to cure many diseases. When we understand the secrets of human bodies, DNA, what is DNA, how it works, and genetics, what is genetics, how this procedure is going on, we are enabled to cure many diseases. We made some vaccines or all that. So it is the result of our technology. Similarly, we use the laws of aerodynamics to develop faster planes. That is the third example, main examples of technology, how the technology helps us. When we learn the law of aerodynamics, when we saw the birds, how they are flying in the sky, the law of aerodynamics comes to our scientists' minds. And from there, we were able to develop the faster planes today, right? So in these three examples, you saw the role of technology behind it and the laws of nature, the capability of human beings to understand the law of nature. As we are able to understand the law of nature, we change our lifestyle, we begin to develop. So in short, which which concept provide us the possibility of development. It was the nature. First of all, we understand the nature. We understand the natural laws, and it gives us possibility to develop. So when in the primitive society or in the stage of humanization of nature, we were totally depend upon the nature. But now we are able to understand the natural law with the help of technology. And technology loosens the shackles of environment on human beings. The environment of human beings means when we were totally depend upon the nature in the age of humanization of nature and human beings, sorry, naturalization of human beings. But the technology enable us to shackle this shackles, technology enables us to loosen the shackle of the environment. Now we have the possibility to interact with the natural environment, and no doubt it greatly influenced it, but now we are able to understand it. We can adopt it according to our need. So there were the possibility of our development due to the facility of technology and by the understanding of natural laws. So where there is the possibility of human beings, that term is known as the possibilism. So where there is a possibility, yani means the earlier scholars term these as possibilism, where the nature provides us some possibility to develop ourselves. Now we are able to develop the health resorts on highlands, urban sprawls, hills, orchards, pastures in plains and rolling hills, ports on the coast, oceanic routes on the oceanic surface, and satellites and many more. All these are the efficient technology and better use of natural things. Passage of time, we have loosened the shackle of the nature. We have started the use of technology, and these possibilities we get from the nature. So where there is a possibility of our development given by the nature, that term is known as possibility. Possibilism means ready to go where for the development. Means this term indicate that there are the possibility of your development, and you have to choose these possibilities and go through with your development. Right, now come to the third one. The third term, humanization of nature. So nature provides opportunities and human being make use of these, and slowly nature gets humanized and start bearing the imprints of human endeavor. Now what we do, we gain these opportunities. The opportunities provided by the nature, we get it and make better use of these opportunities, and slowly and gradually the nature gets humanized. Yani means the nature is under the control of human beings. There are two stories which indicate the two situation. First is naturalization of human. Let's a few on these stories. Panda lives in the wilds of the Abhuj Mart area of central India. His village consists of three huts deep in the wilds. Not even birds or stray dogs that usually crowd villages can be seen in these areas. No one was there. Wearing a small loin cloth and armed with eggs, he slowly surveys the panda where his tribe practices a primitive form of agriculture called shifting cultivation. So all these indicate that he is living in a primitive society where there is no clothing system. They wear only skin of the animals, and they use primitive tools and primitive type of agriculture called shifting cultivation. Benna and his friends burn small patches of forest. Now this is the type of what is shifting agriculture or cultivation. So first of all, he cleared some forest, burn small patches of forest, and the ash is used for making the soil fertile. Benna is happy that the mahua trees around him are in bloom. How lucky I am to be a part of this beautiful universe, he thinks as he looks up to see the mahua, palash and sal trees that have sheltered him since childhood. So he was very happy living in the nature. Crossing the panda in a gliding motion, Benna makes his way to a stream. He went to a stream. As he bends down to scoop up a palm full of water, he remembered there was no glass or whatever they use their palms to drink the water. He remembers to thank Loe Lugi, the spirit of the forest, for allowing him to quench his thirst. Moving on with his friends, Benna chews on succulent leaves and roots. What he ate, the leaves and the roots of the trees, right? So he is totally dependent upon the nature for his shelter, for his clothing, for his food habits. The boys have been trying to collect gajra and kuchla from the forest. These are special plants that Benna and his people use. He hopes the spirits of the forest will be kind and lead him to these herbs. Now, these are the types of some herbs which he used as medicines. These are needed to barter in the Madhai or tribal fair coming up the next full moon. Next full moon, yani every full moon, there was a fair in which he will use it as a medicine or for trading purpose. He closes his eyes and tries hard to recall what the elders had taught him about these herbs and the places they are found in. Now he recalls that where these medicines found in these areas and herbs. He wishes he had listened more carefully. Suddenly there is a resulting of leaves. Benna and his friends know it is the outsiders who have come searching for them in the wilds. Wilds means forest. In a single fluid motion, Benna and his friends disappear behind the thick canopy of the trees and become one with the spirit of the forest. Now some foreigners came. Foreigners means the outsider. Outsider came to the jungles to search them, and they disappeared and they hide themselves from being captured by the outsiders. So this story is all about the primitive society. It indicates the naturalization of human beings, when the human beings beings are totally depend upon the nature. Still, it is practiced in our northeastern areas. In the northeastern areas, some tribal castes are still practicing the same procedure. They are still depend upon the nature. They are still living in the forest, right? So this story is all about the naturalization of human. Now the next story is humanization of nature. Winters in the town of Trondheim means fierce winds and heavy snow, means chill winter was prevailing there. The skies are dark for months. Carrie drives to work in the dark at 8 a.m. She has special tires for the winter and keeps the headlights of her powerful car switched on because there was a deep dark outside. So she have to keep their headlights on. Her office is artificially heated at a comfortable 23 degrees Celsius because there was a chilled cold in that area. So they were using heaters. The campus of the university she works in is built under a huge glass dome. This dome keeps the snow out in winter. Now here you can see, means the natural way, natural environment was very chilled and cold and there was too darkness outside. But how they changed this environment? By the use of heater, by switching on their headlights, they can remove the darkness. Now what is going on? They are changing their nature according to their needs. Means they are going to change the nature according to the needs of human beings. So this story is showing the humanization of nature when we control the nature to a great extent. No doubt we can't stop the environment to be cold, but we can prevent ourselves from being cold by using the heater. So this is the changing process which is going on through the humanization of nature. So this dome keeps the snow out in winter and lets in the sunshine in the summer. So they make the their roofs as a glass dome so that the snow can be whipped out from that roofs. The temperature is controlled carefully and there is adequate lightning. Even though fresh vegetables and plants don't grow in such harsh weather, because agriculture required some specific climate to be grown. So the harsh climate, whether it is too cold or too hot, the people are not able to grow the vegetables or plants, but they are getting, she is getting vegetables and plants in that area by the trading, by the exporter and import. Carrie keeps on an orchid on her desk and enjoys eating tropical fruits like banana and kiwi. Tropical fruits which are grown in the tropical areas near the equator areas, but she is enjoying it in the polar regions. That is showing the trading or the transportation of the things. These are flown in from warmer areas regularly. With a click of the mouse, Carrie can network with colleagues in New Delhi. Jaise ki, like we are interacting through the technology this time, you know, because the schools are closed, but we are interacting. We are keep on our studying by the using of IT. By technology. So this is also an example of humanization of nature. She frequently takes a morning flight to London and returns in the evening in time to watch her favorite television serial. So the whole world become a small village. We can go to any area with the help of airplanes or flights and come back to our native place in the evening. We are able to do this by the help of only technology. So Carrie is 58 years old. She is fitter and looks younger than many 30 years old in other parts of the world. So she used some beauty products, and in the age of 58 she looks like a younger age, like 30 years. So all these examples are showing that human beings control the nature to a great extent, and nature, no doubt nature had a great impact on the human beings, but we have controlled the nature to a great extent, and this situation is known as the humanization of nature. So the story box represents a direct relationship of a household belonging to an economically primitive society with nature. And you will realize that in all such cases, nature is a powerful force, worshipped, revered, and conserved, right? So there is a direct dependence of the nature of human beings. This is called humanization of nature. But can you imagine what has made such a lifestyle possible? It is technology that has allowed. In the second story, this can be possible through the technology. It is the technology that has allowed the people of Trondheim and others to overcome constraints imposed by nature. Whatever there is obstacle by the nature or anything, we can remove these obstacles by the help of technology now, right? So, but do you know about some other such instances? Some examples are not difficult to find, no? You can give your own examples during the COVID-19, right? But in this situation, as I told you, there were three situations. First was humanization, naturalization of human. Second is possibilism. And third is humanization of nature. No doubt we are using the nature frequently day by day, but it is to harm us in the different forms. There are some climatic diseases. Climates are there, like floods, droughts, ozone layer depletion is going on. All these processes is the result of our development. So there must be a mutual way between the situation of naturalization of human and the humanization of nature. And that way is given by the by a geographer named Griffith Taylor. He introduced another concept which reflects a middle path between the two ideas of environmental determinism and possibilism. And this idea is known as neo-determinism and stop and go determinism. The middle path between the two terms, environmental determinism means naturalization of human, and possibilism is neo-determinism. What is neo-determinism? He took an example to define or to describe the term neo-determinism. He took an example of traffic light. In the cities, there is a traffic light who controls the traffic at the crossroads. Red light means stop. Stop, it means, it indicates the term or the situation where we were stopped. That was the situation of naturalization of human. When we are in the control of nature, we can't go anywhere. We have to obey the nature. He compared that situation with the red light, means stop. There is no possibility, right? Amber light provides a gap between red and green lights to get set. That means yellow light. Yellow light means get set, go. Chicken, get set means there is a possibilities. This indicates the second situation, possibilities. When we saw the possibilities in nature to develop ourselves. So nature said that you can go through with your development with the help of me. So the second light, yellow, indicates the possibility situation. And the third one, green light means go. It is a situation, yes, you can go now. So by this situation, we started to develop ourselves with the use of technology, by understanding the laws of nature. So the concept shows that neither is there a situation of absolute necessity when we are totally controlled by the nature, nor is there a condition of absolute freedom, means go, and we can use the nature to a great extent without thinking about the nature, right? So there is a not absolute freedom. It means that human beings can conquer nature by obeying it. It is the middle path. We can use the nature, but at the same time, we must obey it. They have to respond to the red signals and can proceed in their pursuits of development when nature permits the modification. Wherever nature permits us to modify it itself, then we can go through with our development. We cannot go beyond the nature's permission, right? It means that possibilities can be treated within the limits with which do not damage the environment, and there is no free run without accidents. If we are standing on a traffic light and when the green light on, we press the accelerator and drive, just thinking about anything else surrounding us, what it will be happen? There will be an accident. More and more chances of the accident will be there. Same happened in the nature. If the nature gives us possibility to our development, no doubt we must develop. But if we use the nature frequently, indiscriminately, no doubt the nature will punish us in the form of natural calamities like ozone layer depletion, global warming, receding glaciers, landslides, degrading lands. So the neo-determinism conceptually attempts to bring a balance, nullifying the either or dichotomy. So students, I think you are able to understand all the terms which are most important in this chapter. First is naturalization of human. Keep remember that in this is a situation when the human beings are totally controlled by the nature. Second is possibilism, where there is the possibility of our development with the help of technology. That situation is known as possibilism. And third is humanization of nature. This situation is that when the human beings modifying the nature, yes, neo-determinism is a midway of midway between the naturalization of human and possibilism, right? Okay, so students, you have to make the notes of the topics covered till now. The next topic we will start in our next lecture. If you have any doubt, now you can ask. If you have any doubt, you can ask now. Just raise your hands or unmute yourself. Chetan, Dev, Janvi. Have you understood? Jashika, Jatin, Kirti. Okay, then we are leaving the meeting now. Have a good day, students.